of this talk's about today is associated to a research program we've got going here at the moment, which is looking at how we can describe dose distributions beyond dose volume histograms. Just two dates or so, 2017. So we're trying to look at how we can describe dose distributions more succinctly in how they're spatially distributed. So there's another big group doing this in Rennes in France, and this is where Jenny comes from. So originally from Greece, she's come to us via Rennes. So Jenny is here until the start of April, and so this is a sort of a key collaboration for us. And so Jenny's going to present work she's been doing in her PhD so far. Plenty of seats down the front.
We put the seats close to the front for a reason.
I think I've kind of jumped into the front, yeah.
Thank you for coming. Yes, I have studied medical physics in Greece, and now I'm doing my PhD in France. It's a laboratory where we're working on image processing, applications in medicine. And specifically, me, I'm working on a special localization of dose toxicity relationship in prostate cancer. Urinary toxicity is mostly related to the dose delivered to the bladder, and likely the dose delivered to the urethra, the prostatic urethra. However, the existing models of urinary toxicity are failing to predict toxicity. So the aim of my work is to try to identify some subregions in the bladder and the urethra that to possibly explain the dose effect relationship. So the main question to answer for me is if there is a spatial relationship between the distribution of the dose within these two structures, the bladder and the urethra, and urinary toxicity, and also within a personalized treatment, if we can increase prediction and eventually reduce toxicity. So predictive models of toxicity traditionally are based on dose volume histograms. It's a long established tool, however it has a main drawback, which is that it reduces the 3D dose distribution in a monodimensional representation. In this way, we are losing information. And in order to overcome this, more recently, dose surface maps have been used, which actually describe the dose on the surface of the organ. So somehow we preserve the information of this 3D dose distribution. But still, we don't know what happens inside the organ. We don't have information about it. And also, we cannot evaluate multiple structures at the same time. So the third approach, which we're using in our laboratory, it's based on dose volume maps, which actually describes the dose both on the surface and inside the organ. In this way, we can identify regions where we have different dose differences between two populations, for example. And also, it allows to study multiple structures at the same time. In the past, we have used this method to study rectal toxicity, and we have found a subregion which was related with the dose to this subregion was related with rectal bleeding. And so I'm applying a similar method in order to study urinary toxicity this time. So the population dataset that I used consists of 272 patients that have been treated with IMRT or IGRT, coming from two multicentric prospective three trials. The mean follow-up was 50 months, and the dose delivered to the prostate was either 78 or 80 days. The endpoints that I studied is divided based on the symptom to hematuria, frequency, dysuria, retention, and incontinence. Also, based on the severity of the symptom, I have looked at grade 1 and grade 2 toxicities, and also the time of the event. If it was before 6 months, it was considered as acute toxicity, and later as late toxicity. Specifically, I looked at 5 years late toxicity. So this is the workflow of my study. I have divided it in seven steps. So first of all, we have the input data. This is the contour of the organs, the bladder and the prostate. We have also the 3D dose distribution, the planning 3D dose distribution, and the clinical history and toxicity scoring for each patient. So since we want to also study the urethra, we need to first of all identify the urethra on the CT scan, which actually it's not possible because we don't have enough contrast. For this reason, we developed an algorithm. It's a multi-atlas based segmentation method where we use as an atlas brachytherapy patients which have undergone a procedure where a catheter was inserted in order to make possible to see the urethra on the CT scan. So the atlas is built from these patients, the brachytherapy patients, and then we are using an input patient. We are looking, we are searching for the closest, anatomically closest patients in the atlas, and we do a fusion of the image in order to find the probability map of the urethra. And that's how we identify the urethra for all the patients in our cohort. The next step is the registration. We need actually to register all the patients in a common coordinate system. In order to do that, we need to select a patient who will serve as a template. For us, this was the average patient. It was the patient with the average prostate volume, bladder volume, and urethral length. And the next step was actually to perform the registration. So for the registration, we are first aligning the images, the prostates actually, and then we are deforming the image in order to have as a result a deformation field, which is then applied to the dose distribution in order to propagate all the dose distribution, all the images of the dose distribution to a common coordinate system, and then to be able to perform an analysis. More specifically here we can see we have a patient, we are registering it to the template, this means we are deforming this patient, the image. We produce a deformation field and we apply this deformation field on the dose distribution. And after we have done this for all the patients, we have propagated all the dose distribution to the common coordinate system, which is the space of the template, we are able to perform a voxel-wise analysis. This means we perform a statistical test at every single voxel of the image. So the voxel analysis is performed separately for each endpoint studied. This means that we are splitting the data set between patients with that toxicity and without the toxicity. And at each voxel, we perform a non-parametric test. It's a Mann-Whitney-U test. And the result is, on the right, we can see the dose difference map. It shows the mean dose difference between patients who had toxicity and the patients who didn't have toxicity. So at each voxel we have this dose difference, and there is a corresponding p-value map which shows if this difference is significant. So by thresholding the 3D p-value map at the significant p-value, which shows 0.01, we were able to find specific subregions where we had a statistically significant dose difference between the two populations. The final step was to propagate the subregions from the space of the template back to the space of the native space of each patient, allowing us to have a personalized idea of where these subregions are located in the specific anatomy of the patient. And then we performed some regression analysis in order to see if, by looking at the dose in the subregion, if we could better discriminate patients with and without the symptom. So in order to go back to the native space, we are just using the inverse transformation of the registration step, and we are propagating the subregions for each patient. And then we calculate the DPH in each subregion and the entire bladder This was just for reference to compare the DBH of the bladder and the DBH of the subregion. And then we performed the regression analysis. So these are the main results, the subregions that we have found. We found for five different symptoms. They are mostly located in the posterior part of the bladder, close to the bladder trigone, which is an important structure as has been shown in the literature. And also we found a subregion, a dose, the dose to the urethra was also associated with urinary toxicity. And to our surprise, we found a subregion on the superior part, which is expected to be the low dose region. I have also a 3D video, 3D animation of the location of these subregions. And more specifically on these results, first of all, on acute toxicity, I found subregions only for two symptoms. This was acute incontinence and acute retention. For acute incontinence, we have a subregion in the urethra. And for acute retention, the subregion is mostly located in the bladder trigone. So on the left, there is the dose distribution for patients with and without toxicity. In the middle, we can see the dose difference between the two groups. And on the right, there is we have actually four dose volume histograms. The continuous lines are the dose volume histograms in the subregion. The dashed lines are the dose volume histograms in the entire bladder. The red line is for patients with toxicity, and the green line is the patients without toxicity. Also, there is when this difference between the two DVH is significant, we can see there is a shadowed region. For example, for acute retention, both the DVH of the subregion and the DVH of the entire bladder were statistically significant between the two groups. For 5 years late toxicity, we found three subregions. This was for hematuria, retention, and dysuria. For hematuria, it's located on the superior part, close to the blood, to the bladder dome. And for dysuria,
use this laser if you want.
Thank you. So for hematuria, it's on the bladder dome mostly. And for retention and dysuria, it's located in the posterior part. Also for dysuria, we found as well that both the DVH of the subregion and the DVH of the entire bladder were significant between the two groups. Here is the result of the prediction capability of our model of the dose to the subregion compared. It's compared to the entire bladder. So we have evaluated both the mean dose in the subregion and the entire bladder, and the DVH. The results show that for three subregions, we could better predict and discriminate patients with and without a toxicity when we were using the dose of the subregion compared to the bladder, where we could not find, we could not actually predict anything. And also, for two other subregions, we found that both the entire bladder and the subregion were predictive, but the score actually, when using the subregion, was slightly higher. And the results were confirmed in multivariable analysis where we included the clinical parameters. So in conclusion, we can say that, first of all, the voxel-wise analysis allows to study multiple structures at the same time compared to other methods. And also in this specific study, we found that some subregions, the dose to some subregions was associated with specific urinary symptoms. But we should point out that correlation between local dose and the toxicity does not necessarily mean causality. So these results have to be validated. First of all, we need to validate the results on an external cohort because the predictive capability of the model was evaluated internally. And also, all the analysis was performed in the planning dose distribution, which is not necessarily the dose that is being delivered, because especially the bladder is a highly extensible organ, and we don't really know. Okay, for the bladder base, it's a stable region, but for the rest of the bladder, since the patient undergoes 40 fractions, I think, it is possible that other parts will receive different dose during the treatment. Finally, the perspective of this work is to transfer it to the clinic. So if we use it in the treatment planning system, we would be able to make a treatment plan and find these subregions in the specific anatomy of our patient, and then possibly adapt the treatment plan and find the balance between the target coverage and sparing some important subregions that possibly would reduce toxicity.
Questions for you?
Hey, the data which you used in this in this research, this data is the patient data which is related to the IGRD based patient data, or just you just use the patient the information and that's just dump the plan on the actual CT scan? Are that this is adaptive radiotherapy plans, or is just a simple?
No, it's not adaptive.
So then you did the 5-year analysis. Then how you can say that this is the real reproductions of the dose at this particular organ, because each day the bladder filling and the rectum positions and all this and everything is not exactly the same position all the time, but in CT scan it's like a static scan.
Yes, exactly. That's what I said at the end, that we actually have a CT scan, a simple CT scan, and a simple 3D dose distribution, but it was a planning 3D dose distribution. So all the analysis is based on this data. That does not necessarily mean that it is actually the true image of the patient during the treatment, or the true dose that is delivered. But we are trying to use the basic clinical protocol, let's say, in order to make something that we can use in an everyday clinical practice. So identifying these subregions with a more complex way, maybe it wouldn't allow to transfer it to the clinic as easily as it would be this. And also, if we validate the result in an external cohort, that could possibly mean that there's something more than what we were thinking. I don't know if I understood correctly your question.
Can you go back to your picture with the subregions on?
Yes.
Yeah. So I was just surprised, I think, that the blue subregion is on the left of the screen.
The
lateral one, that one.
Yes.
And there's not one balancing it on the right.
Yeah, that's
and
true.
And as a naive physicist, I thought that anatomy was more uniform. One doctor in them. Do you think that's logical, or is that just an...
I think that it doesn't make sense to have a subregion over here.
Yeah.
And possibly it's associated with the dose beam. So maybe maybe this is the subregion, and this is just another part that receives high dose, but due to the location of the beam.
Yeah.
So I guess that that's the region we have a subregion on the side.
I wonder whether it was to do with, because you pick one data set to deform everything to, and if you picked a different data set to deform everything to, whether they would deform differently and that point would move more. I don't know enough about deformation.
No, I don't understand the question.
So I was trying to work out why it might be. I think
yes.
You're right, it looks to me like an artifact.
Yes.
And I wondered, you take all your data sets and you deform it to your average
yes.
model. But if you'd picked a different average model,
yeah.
then they would all deform subtly differently, and that might be what's explained.
That's true. That's true. Actually, I started with a different template. I changed the template due to the registration results, actually, because they were not high enough. And I noticed on the first template, the regions were more or less the same, but possibly this would not appear in another template. But yes, that's one of the problems of the registration. That
I mean, it might be another way to validate your data set.
To
change,
yes.
To change it,
that's, yes.
Yes, an external one would be great, but...
Yes, that's an idea. Yes, that's something that we have thought already and we would like to test it.
Wasn't Oscar talking about clustering the data sets and
yes.
then having a different template for each cluster so that
yes, an idea. Yes, exactly. An idea is to try to cluster the data set and have different templates based on the anatomy of the patient. It's in like an atlas based registration.
Is there a physiological difference between the regions that you've identified? I guess they're anatomically different.
I imagine that, I believe that the bladder is not homogeneously radiosensitive.
Okay.
So, and actually, that's what the result shows, that if we find a region that, a specific region where the dose is higher, and for this region patients had higher toxicity, it maybe implies that bladder is a serial organ, or maybe for some toxicities it acts as a serial organ, and some others, like for the toxicity that we found both the entire bladder and the subregion, maybe for this acts as a parallel. So maybe it depends on the toxicity. But I believe that, for example, we know that incontinence it can be related to the dose to the urethra, mostly because there are some muscles here, the urethral sphincter, I think, which possibly with the radiation we are damaging these muscles, and that's a result that makes sense. Also, maybe the contractability of the bladder, maybe it's not uniform. So if we irradiate specific regions, that would affect how easily the bladder contracts and would result to some toxicities.
If you go back to the slide, if you go forward a little bit, to this one, for example.
Yes.
So some places, the patients with toxicity had a lower dose than the patients without toxicity.
Yes.
How would you explain that?
Yes, because actually it's only on the bladder, because the dashed lines are in the bladder. So when we are looking on the DPH of the entire bladder, this is patient, yes, without toxicity, and this is with toxicity. For example, in this case, when we are looking on the entire bladder, we don't find any correlation between the DPHs. Maybe it makes sense. I mean, we don't necessarily find a difference between the two groups in the entire bladder, on the DPH on the entire bladder. And especially when we have found the subregions in the urethra, we wouldn't expect to have a difference in the bladder.
Mm-hmm. So when you looked at the predictive results, you
yes.
had the DPHs and then the subregions.
Yes.
Are they separate, or did you try combining them to get even more predictive?
Yeah. Yes, we combined it in a multivariate analysis when we included both the clinical data. And yes, actually these are the results of the the area under the curve is from a univariate analysis, and when using a multivariate, it augmented slightly the prediction.
You said that there's a possible error with the way each day bladder and the rectum can change shape slightly, so if you're basing all of your data off one planning CT, which might not necessarily be consistent throughout treatment. Have you considered taking cone beams each day and then deforming your planning CT, your planning dose to match that cone beam? Then each day you get an actual delivered dose, which you can add on each day theoretically the dose you've actually delivered to the bladder.
But we don't have that for the base, for the data set that we use. So, and we could have used, but we had a few patients with cone beam, but they were not enough to perform statistical analysis. So,
there's a couple of studies that have done that already. It actually makes a remarkably little difference. The significance of the predictions are not improved much at all. Well, if you've got enough patient numbers, then that averages out.
I mean, you're looking at dose volume rather than dose wall. I presume it's the bladder wall that's affected, but by looking at the volume, which is including some urine, that might also be where that wall is going to fall into
in
your cone beam, so you're taking account of that.
That's one question that we had on mind first by seeing the results, because we found some regions, it makes sense to be close to the surface of the organ, but also they are going on the interior part. And we are thinking that possibly that explains the fact that the bladder is deforming and actually is going to that subregion. And that would make sense.
So if you want to take that to a logical conclusion, assuming that the bladder deforms around where it is at its initial CT, it doesn't always get smaller, sometimes it's going to get bigger.
Yes.
So you probably want to be doing this not on a bladder, but on a bladder plus.
Yes, plus
centimeter.
That's true, but also I think according to the literature, the bladder usually on the planning CT is slightly bigger than it gets later, I mean during the treatment. So it's more possible to find the bladder later on inside the volume than outside.
Right, well, thanks to Jen for coming up to Australia and for...
It's my pleasure. And working with Martin, it's a pleasure and honour, actually.
Yeah, and just, while she's here, just see her in the corridor, just say hi and make her feel welcome.
We always say hi.
That's true, thank you.
Thanks again, so.